Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court, my name is Bruce Wong, and I represent the petitioners. We would like to reserve the 2 minutes for the rebuttal. This case, the petitioner's husband, Ernesto Gonzalez Chavez, had a very successful taxi business in Uruapan, Mexico. Around 2008, while he was driving his taxi, he got into a heated argument with another driver. Shortly after that argument, petitioner's husband was kidnapped by the criminal organizational group Familia Michoacan, FM. And during his captivity, the petitioner's husband was severely beaten, handcuffed, and forced to remain lying down most of the time while he was being held in captivity. Now, the FM called the petitioner, the lead petitioner here, repeatedly and demanded 200,000 pesos for his release. And because of their situation, financial situation, the petitioner was able to get the money, and the petitioner's husband was released. But after the husband was released, the FM still insisted on monthly payments, and they requested 5,000 pesos monthly, which Ernesto did for about 3 years.
So the IJ and BIA said this was about the money, and it was not persecution based on a protected ground. How do you respond to that?
Well, as you know, you can have multiple, as the cases in Perzmova versus McCasey, a persecutorial act may have multiple causes. You know, if you looked at the circumstances and the facts, once he fled, the husband fled, then they decided to target the wife. And that suggests that possibly that is a protected ground. They targeted her based on one of the protected grounds on the arguments.
How would you distinguish this case from our recent decision in Rodriguez-Zuniga?
Well, we have three protected grounds here, and family-based, but also she reported to the police, and she would have a well-founded fear of future persecution on account of that. Objectively and reasonably, that's how we'd be distinguishable possibly from the Rodriguez case.
Well, I take it that case distinguished Ayala and some of these other extortion plus cases by saying that the reason that the alleged persecutor was extorting was simply to get money. They would have done it regardless. In that case, she would have done it regardless of any family relationship. How is that not also the case here in terms of the pursuit of your client?
Well, if you look at some of the comments that were made, I mean, they called her up in 2011 and they basically said, we have not forgotten. Now, it might not be animus, like the brief and the government says, but clearly they had some kind of vendetta, possibly.
Vendetta against her husband? On what account?
That he took off and he stopped paying the 5,000 pesos, Your Honors. So, once the petitioner refused to pay, she contacted the police. And the country condition reports indicate that the police is very corrupt in Mexico, even though not every police officer or every police, but when they asked to meet her out in the public, which was about 30 minutes away from her house, it was, you know, reasonable for her to feel that maybe something was wrong. So she never followed through with the police report, and subsequently she left the country around after that, and she came to the United States in 2015.
Is there any claim here of political persecution based on the police's conduct towards her?
No, it's more like a future fear that she has because she doesn't know who the police were. If not every police officer, of course, is corrupt, but I think from the circumstances, she had a reasonable belief that this situation was.
What do we make of her testimony that about how it all has to do with the money, right? When we're looking at this and saying, you know, substantial evidence review, why isn't that substantial evidence supporting the IJ and BIA decision that this was not on account of family membership or some other protected criteria?
No, she did say that in her hearing, but, you know, she's not a lawyer. She clearly, if she wasn't a family member, I don't think she would have been targeted. If she was just a stranger on the street, I don't think the FM would have been calling her or anything like that. So,
does it matter why her husband was targeted in the first place?
Well, for the family situation, it would matter, yes, because she's the spouse, immediate relative of petitioner's husband. So, we urge this court to find that there's a nexus, and there's a nexus to a protected ground, Your Honors.
Okay, we'll let you save the balance of your time for rebuttal.
Yes, Your Honor.
We'll hear from the government.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court, my name is Julia Tyler. I represent the Attorney General in this case. I'd like to start off by just addressing Your Honor's questions about the nexus to the family in this case. Herrera never testified that Familia Miahuachcan said anything to her about her family per se, or tied the threats to her membership in Ernesto's family. And when asked, as Judge Johnstone said, when she asked why she'd be targeted, she said, I'm sorry, it was Judge Bress, it all has to do with the money. We know that one cannot establish nexus based on a family membership simply because a family exists and some family members have experienced harm. Yet that is exactly what petitioners are arguing here. So let's talk about some of those family members. It is true that Ernesto's brother, Rene, was targeted for extortion and kidnapped as well. But Herrera testified that Ernesto had 13 living siblings in Uruapan, and yet the only sibling, that was similarly extorted was Rene, who also, like Ernesto, owned several taxis and enjoyed a, quote, very stable financial situation.
Ms. Tyler, could you help me, given that, can you help me distinguish this from the Ayala case where it was a family hotel business? I mean, is it possible to characterize this as at least partly a they're both in the same business, and their association is because of that business. How does this differ from Ayala?
Well, I don't think there was any reference to anything other than money, number one. I think that in Ayala, this court was struck by the fact that the board had said that extortion couldn't be persecution, and that, or it couldn't be on account of the family. And I think that that kind of just flat, unequivocal statement struck this court as error. I don't think it's clear post Zuniga that animus is important. There was no animus ever expressed to this family. Again, we have this continuity between Rene and Ernesto as being the most financially stable. In fact, Ms. Herrera said that they got the money to release Ernesto from Rene. So it's clear that the gang may have known that Rene also had the money. It's also interesting that Herrera...
So do we know why he was initially kidnapped? I mean, he wasn't kidnapped for extortion, correct?
He was kidnapped to get money, $20,000.
There was a dispute in a cab, and then he was kidnapped, and then they demanded ransom. Is that a fair characterization of the record?
I think that the testimony with regard to the dispute is exceptionally vague.
Yeah, I agree with you. But it says there was a. It doesn't say there was a Just says there was a dispute.
There was a dispute.
An argument.
Mm-hmm.
And then he was kidnapped, and then they demanded ransom.
Right. It could also just as easily have been a coincidence that there was a dispute. I mean, the fact remains that they had a very stable financial situation, and he owned, again.
Let me put the question another way. Is there anything in the record that indicates that he was kidnapped only for extortion?
I think, well, she has the burden, and I think all of the evidence.
I'm just asking what you're
saying. Of course. I cannot think of a single, other than her discussion of a vague dispute that occurred sometime, and we don't even know if it was, I don't think we even know when it was, or how soon, or how far before it was, that sometime thereafter he was
right.
kidnapped.
And the children were threatened too, right?
Well, the children were threatened in the same way that this court distinguished with Zuniga and in Coelho, where you are.
I think my question was they were threatened.
They were threatened.
I didn't.
Sure. I'm
now,
sorry.
Now, if you want to elaborate.
I apologize. Yes. Yes. I think during one of the phone calls, there is testimony that the gang threatened the children because they knew where they were. They knew their seemed to know their patterns and that kind of thing.
They knew their patterns, their classes. Mm-hmm. Now you can answer with what you were going to say about why that doesn't matter.
Well, it because as in Zuniga as in Coelho, the fact that you are threatening a family member is the same reason I think this court said in Zuniga that you would threaten a close friend. Anyone else that particular person would not want harmed and therefore would be motivated to pay the money that the extorters are actually trying to get.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but in Zuniga, did the board reject the proposed social group?
I honestly I don't recall, but they absolutely did address the nexus as well.
No question about that. But they in Zuniga, as I understand it, the board absolutely rejected the proposed social group. Here
they did not.
They did not. They just assumed.
They assumed they were all social groups. Yes, that's correct.
Did the board review the nexus determination for clear error or de novo?
The decision itself repeatedly says that it reviewed the nexus determination for clear error.
Uh-huh. You see where I'm going with this.
I do see where you're going, okay. Your Honor. Yes, I do. If I may address that in a couple of different ways.
Sure.
The first one is that Herrera has waived the issue. I am fully aware that Umana Escobar was decided after the petitioner filed their opening brief. However, they never addressed it. I think my brief on the same day that Umana Escobar was decided. Petitioner did not address Umana Escobar in his reply, and he's not filed a 20HA. So my first argument is that the petitioner has waived the standard of review that was applied if he's going to argue that an erroneous standard of review was applied. Secondly, the board noted that Herrera had not demonstrated that the immigration judge's nexus determination was clearly erroneous, but they cited matter of NM. And they cited matter of NM for the precise proposition that an alleged persecutor's motive is a question of fact to be decided and determined by immigration judges and reviewed for clear error. So they conflated the motivation and the nexus. I would argue this court does that repeatedly as well because we're reviewing nexus for substantial evidence. And so the motivation necessarily flows into the nexus determination. Moreover, in the context of the board's decision, if you read it, it's very fact-intensive. It says it's finding no clear error with respect to the immigration judge's factual findings. And there's an extensive review of the facts in the decision and all of the following paragraphs. This stands in stark contrast to Umana Escobar, in which the court said there was an insufficient indication from the rest of the board's decision that the board's clear error review pertained to the IJ's factual determination. So we do not have that problem here. In addition, if this court were to decide that or to be considering remand for the board to make a clearer articulation of the application of its standard of review, I would argue that that would be futile because under this court's decision in Najm Abadi, this court should not remand when there's no doubt that the board would reach the same conclusion. With several hundred thousand board decisions pending or decisions in cases pending before the board, I do not think that remand in this case would be a good use of either administrative or judicial resources. And finally, the Supreme Court in Ming Dai has instructed that a reviewing court should uphold a decision of less than ideal clarity if the agency's path may reasonably be discerned. I think that for all those reasons, while I agree that board decision is not a model of clarity, I do think that the agency's path can reasonably be discerned.
Thanks for addressing that, Ms. Tyler.
Sure. I just wanted to go back very quickly to talk about this other brother. I think Herrera was asked about, it's important to keep in mind that that Ernesto, the family of Ernesto, he has 13 siblings in Uruapan, and not a single one of them other than Rene and Ernesto were ever extorted. And Herrera, during the hearing, was asked about this another brother. And she said, well, that brother only drove a taxi. He didn't own a taxi. So, and then in the reply brief, Herrera says that she's essentially a partner with her husband in the taxi business. We know that Ernesto's parents would be considered part of the immediate family of Ernesto Chavez. However, they too live in Mexico and the United States, travel back and forth. Nothing's ever happened to them. And they've been back. She is undergoing treatment for cancer, and no one, I think it's also significant to know that no one's ever come after her, asked where she is. I think petitioner's counsel mentioned this very strange call she got from somebody purporting to be the police to meet in a particular plaza. The police apparently never called again. Police never called the mother-in-law. There's just simply, and I would argue, Your Honors, that I heard petitioner's counsel mention that there was the possibility of a vendetta. And I would close by saying that the possibility of a vendetta that is not supported by substantial evidence anywhere in this record does not compel a contrary conclusion than that reached by the agency. And we would respectfully request that the petition for review be denied. Thank you so much, Your Honors.
Thank you. Mr. Wong, rebuttal.
Your Honors, petitioners urge this court to find that there's a nexus, and further than that, there's a mixed mode of analysis here. Like I said in the opening brief, opening statements.
Mr. Wong, if you don't mind, would you do you agree that the initial fight between the husband and apparently a passenger, there's no explanation of that in the record?
Right.
So do you? And there's no. Okay, that's fine.
That's fine. I mean, clearly there's a financial gain here from the cartel, but...
Yeah, the cartel demanded a ransom after the kidnapping, but we don't know what the initial dispute is, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. But there is some evidence in the record that they did have some animus. In 2011, they called the petitioner, the lead petitioner here, and they basically said to her that they did not forget. And what that meant is that they didn't forget that her husband, who was paying money, suddenly just took off. So I don't think what the petitioner's urging this court is that there should be a mixed mode of analysis. You know, the Act states that a protected ground must constitute at least one central reason for the persecutory conduct, but it doesn't require that such reason account for 50% of the persecutor's motivation here. I'm not disputing that there's financial gain, but there's also on account of family, immediate family of Ernesto Gonzalez Chavez. And with respect to the other family members, this petitioner not only was the immediate family member of Ernesto Gonzalez Chavez, but she also refused to comply with the gang's demands, and she also reported them to the authorities. So in final, we urge the court to grant the petition or remand it for further. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wong. We'll thank both counsel for the briefing and argument. This matter is submitted.